Hi, and welcome to Around Amesbury. This is our premiere show, and my name is Meryl Goldsmith, and I'm going to be your host, and we're going to be discussing a lot of what's going on around Amesbury, and we'll be giving you some information at the end of the show on how to send in your show ideas and some contact information as well. It is my supreme pleasure to welcome in two guests to the first show. We have Holly Shea, and we have Patty Hoyt. And I met Holly through the Amesbury Educational Foundation. I'm on the board of directors, and so is Holly, and actually Patty as well. So that's where we all first met. Patty, in addition to being a retired English teacher here at Amesbury High School, she's also the educational coordinator for Lowell's Boat Shop. And you're gonna see how this all fits together, because this is really fascinating. Holly is the mom of Jordan Shea. And I think that any school child in the town of Amesbury has benefited from Jordan Shea. Jordan was deployed in Iraq, and he unfortunately lost his life in 2009. And what Holly has done to honor his memory is really simply amazing. And I want to talk a little bit about Jordan. I didn't get the chance to meet him. My son started school, is younger, so he started school after Jordan probably was, you know, completely graduated or soon, you know, soon thereafter. And but I certainly feel like I know him now. So Holly, tell me a little bit about the early Jordan. What was he like as a kid? Because I'm so inspired by him now. So I want to know a little bit more about him, and I'm sure everybody else would like to as well.
Well, as a child, he certainly was very adventurous and loving and loyal and had a great laugh, loved to read, loved to learn. He was a great kid.
Yeah. Now, you really did this mostly as a single mom.
Yep, for a good part of the time, definitely. His dad passed away from cancer when Jordan was about a year and a half.
Wow.
So I think that's what he credits his early ability to read to. We used to read a lot together. And yeah, he was about a year and a half. His dad had cancer for about a year. It was tough times, but Jordan made it easy in many ways.
Yeah, I mean, he must have been the one positive, you know, light
Absolutely.
To focus on, you know, both while your husband was going through his treatment, I'm sure, and after he passed away.
Absolutely.
So what was Jordan like in elementary school and middle school? What were the kind of things that he enjoyed doing as a youngster?
As a youngster, obviously hanging out with his friends, and he was very sociable. Loved playing basketball in the driveway with his, you know, the neighboring kids. He loved going, we used to go on outings a lot of the times, go to Boston for the day, go to wherever, water country, you know, whatever he wanted to do. I think at that time I was in school as well, so sometimes we'd sit at the kitchen table and do our homework together until he decided homework was optional.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Anyone with a teenager knows that.
Absolutely.
But yeah, definitely.
So even, yeah, elementary years were easy. We called it the dark ages when he got into middle school and early high school that, you know, things changed a little bit.
Yeah, they see the light after a while.
Yeah.
They do, definitely.
Well, I found by the time he was 16 or 17, he loved his mom again, so that was a good thing.
Yeah, that was a good thing. So he graduated in 2005
yes.
from Amesbury High School, and I've had the pleasure through some of the events that happened in Jordan's honor to get to know some of his classmates. What a great class. Do you remember that class, Patty, at
Very
all?
Very well, yes.
Yeah?
They were a wonderful class, and they had to endure the construction project at its worst phase.
Now, was this when there were actually classrooms in the performance center and there's like
and the, yes.
weird, all kinds of weird things going on at the same
right.
time?
And it was supposed to be temporary. So my whole memory of that class tends to have no sound to it except din, because you couldn't hear kids talking to you in your class because you were listening to 12 classes at the same time. It was a very challenging era. But as with everything, that class tends to be memorable because they showed great spirit in getting through it. They didn't complain and whine all the time. So they really handled it well. In fact, that year, I remember taking as my class theme for the rest of my career, and it just fits Jordan so well, and you, Holly, that it's not what happens, it's what you do with what happens that really reveals your character. And I think that was true of the class of 2005. It was certainly true of Jordan, and it's certainly true of you, that, you know, tough things happen, but it's the way that we respond to how things happen that really makes an impact and reveals our own character.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
That's what's special about him.
Now, did that class endure like 4 years of construction?
They had been preparing for it, but their senior year, and when you're a senior, you think, you know, the world revolves around you and everything is supposed to be so special.
Right.
It is. It is a very, very special year in your life.
Yeah.
And so for it to be really kind of chopped up and messed up and that kind of situation, I think what they showed was that they did not let the building under construction stop them from being
they
a great class
like
and having a great time.
They just seem like such a great class.
They really are.
We'll talk about the bowling tournament coming up, but I mean, the amount of his classmates that come out and support everything that's going on, I just find it so wonderful.
Right.
So that's a positive. See, there's always a little positive,
there
you
is.
Know, a
right.
little bit. So I would like to know, Holly, when Jordan first decided to consider going into the service, and, you know, was there one thing or, you know, what pushed him in that direction as he was thinking about his future?
Yeah, that came on sort of gradually. I do remember him being very much impacted by the events of 9/11. That was big.
Yeah.
I think everyone in that time frame was affected by that. And as he was growing up, he decided that he wanted to become a state trooper. And one of the things that he told me was that he would get points on his the test to become a state trooper if he was a veteran, if he had veteran status.
Right, right.
So of course I told him he could study, you know, instead
right.
of that.
But he'd rather
no,
he
had,
yeah. rather
points. So he was working at Salisbury Beach Reservation, and you know, he had me come down, and we were walking around, and he told me that that was his decision, and you know, I remember feeling proud, but scared to death.
Scared to death.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I did ask him to reconsider, but once Jordan made up his mind on something, that was pretty much it. So I had no choice but to support him and what he wanted to do.
Now, did he do this like pretty much after graduating from high school?
Yeah, or? It was within months of graduating that he made the decision, and then it was just the logistics you know, enlisting and, you know, get into boot camp and all of that stuff, basic training, whatever.
So he ended up being based out of Fort Lewis in Washington State, correct?
Yes,
ultimately.
He was, his basic training was in Georgia at Fort Benning, but right from there he went directly to Fort Lewis, and then he was deployed within probably a month or two.
Wow.
It was quick.
Wow.
It was during the big surge.
That was the big surge.
Okay. All right. So what year was that in June?
So that would have been 2007, late 2006, early 2007.
Now, did he have more than one deployment? So did he go and come back and then he went? Okay.
So the first time he went, he actually went to meet up with a unit who was already there, who had lost quite a few of their, of the platoon.
Yeah.
And so the first time, I believe he stayed 6 or 7 months, and then he came back, stayed in Fort Lewis, and they have to stay here for a couple of years before they go back. I think the turnaround time was probably a little shorter than a few years, though. And then he went back in July of 2009.
Okay, all right. And that's the year that he passed away.
Yeah, just a few months later.
Just a few months later. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've, you know, gotten to know Jordan posthumously and heard a lot about him, and he was quite a writer and a blogger about his experiences, which I found really fascinating. And his point of view about what was happening in the world was pretty interesting.
Yes, definitely.
So can you talk about that a little
bit? Sure. He wrote a blog called Through Amber Lenses, and the reason for that is the color of sunglasses that he chose to wear. But he was a very witty writer, very humorous. He was gaining quite a following. There was a writer named, Alex Horton, who was writing Army of Dude, I think it was called, and he gave Jordan's blog a shout out.
Oh, wow.
Which helped Jordan gain quite a few followers, and that was very gratifying and satisfying for him. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was very pleased with that.
Now, was he, I mean, you said as a small child he enjoyed reading. What, was he a writer in high school? I mean, did he enjoy that?
Well, when we could get him to do something.
Yeah.
He wrote beautifully.
Yeah. I guess when he did it on his own terms, it was
was
a little bit more
typical.
As opposed to Mrs. Hoyt putting this essay is due on this
day. You
know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
In fact, one of the first entries in his blog said something about, you know, my mother has always been telling me to write. My teachers have always been telling me to write. I'm finally going to take their advice and write. And that's how it all started.
Good. Yeah. So it wasn't for his lack of enjoyment. It was that he just didn't feel like doing it,
grow into those.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think writing is for a lot of people a growing into, you know, activity as well.
And have something to say.
And
have something to
write about.
Yes.
Absolutely.
He had a lot to share.
And so some of what he shared was kind of chilling in a way, a little bit, because he was feeling that perhaps he wasn't going to come home.
Well, I think anyone in that situation would be questioning their mortality.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I also wonder, too, it's something I didn't really think a lot about until after the fact, but where his dad passed away at such a young age. And I wonder if Jordan always wondered if that same fate could fall upon him.
You know. Mm-hmm.
So it's hard to tell exactly what he was thinking. Wasn't something that he spoke of a lot, but he certainly identified a lot with his father, even, you know, his pursuits like mountain climbing and so forth, and
didn't come from me.
Yeah.
That was his dad all the way, and the itchy feet, as he called it.
He always wanted
to travel, and that was definitely his dad.
And that's so interesting because, you know, your husband passed away when he was really young.
Yes.
And I mean, he just really, I mean, you must have obviously, you know, as he grew up, you know, talked a lot about him.
Absolutely.
And he just felt very connected, I'm sure.
Well, it was, it would have been difficult to not make the connection because he was like his dad in so many ways.
Mm-hmm.
Very even-tempered, very calm. It took a lot to get him riled up.
Yeah.
Very loyal. His best qualities came from his dad, without a doubt.
Well, great qualities to go into the service, too.
Right.
I mean,
right.
Really, you know, if you look at it that way.
Sure.
So, in 2009, Jordan was killed in action.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just...
It was a shock for the entire town.
The entire town.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes.
It was.
Now, was Jordan the first Amesbury soldier who
that
was
I remember,
killed? That you
yes.
remember?
First
right.
in sort of modern times.
Right. That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Newburyport had Derek Hines.
Derek Hines, yes, absolutely.
Right. Yeah. A few years
grown
before.
Grown up in Amesbury.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was a few years almost to the day, which was interesting.
Mm. Mm, that's really interesting.
Mm. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, Jordan had expressed himself that should anything, you know, happen to him, what his wishes were, and he really... He really gave you a big task, Holly. He was like, come on, Mom, you know. Can you talk about that a little bit? Because that was like, I don't want a bake sale, Mom. I know I'm kind of boiling it down in simplistic terms, but that's really what he expressed.
He definitely left the execution of it up to us. But in a letter home, he wrote something about, this is stuff that I have to tell you just in case. It was called a just in case letter.
Yeah.
And so the letter expressed exactly what he wanted and for whom he wanted the scholarship. He wanted it specifically for students who wanted to become firefighters or policemen.
Mm-hmm.
We broadened it a little bit for anyone going into a helping profession.
Right.
And anyone that we thought that Jordan would say, give this kid some money.
Right.
He's definitely... We think about that as we award the scholarship, certainly. But in the letter, he didn't tell us exactly how he wanted it done, just that he wanted it done.
Right.
And there was no way that I could have done what he wanted without help from everybody. Mm-hmm. I mean, all I did was put the word out to Kathy Toomey, mm-hmm. and said, here's what Jordan wanted. And she said, oh, okay. I've got the people you.
Right. Absolutely. And that's right. You know, really great. How yes. we mm-hmm. all became connected, yes. you know, right. is... that you're kind of using the Amesbury Educational Foundation mm-hmm. to help award and manage
yes.
Jordan's mm-hmm. dreams for what he wanted to have happen. Mm-hmm. And he also had, you know, specific information for his fiancée, because he was engaged at the time when he passed,
he correct? He was, yes, yeah. I mean, in by all I would say mm-hmm. he was just about engaged.
Yeah, yeah, yes. Yeah.
Kelsey Chantanet. He had Chantanet. Called me yes. and said yeah. he was going to do something totally unromantic. I think he was going to take her to like Normandy Beach or something that okay. an army guy would appreciate.
Yes, yeah. right.
I said, yeah. you know, Paris.
Paris might be better.
Like a Kelsey. Okay,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
so that was actually the last telephone call we had had. He had called from Kuwait, mm-hmm. Where they get kind of ready to go back to Iraq. Mm-hmm. And he was telling me that. He's like, that's what I want to do. And when we get on break, that's what, because they would have got a break in between
mm-hmm. right.
During their deployment. And he said, that's what I want to do.
And how many days, weeks, whatever, was that last phone call from when he passed away?
Probably a month.
Probably mm-hmm. a month, wow.
Yeah, okay. yeah. Yes, and he left specific instructions on what I was to do for Kelsey, and he told me what Kelsey would say. He wanted to make sure that she was going to go to grad school, mm-hmm. and he said, and don't let her say no, because she'll try that.
Yeah.
So he was mm-hmm. very loyal to those yeah. you
wow.
know that he loved.
That's beautiful.
And,
mm-hmm.
and he adored her. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We're going to take a break for just a minute and come back, and when we come back, I want to talk about how all of Jordan's dreams have really come true through the Amesbury Educational Foundation.
Hey, I'm Anderson Cooper. As a parent, you want to make sure that your child knows how to deal with bullying when they see it happening. And chances are they want to help, but they don't really know how. I'll teach them that the best thing to do is calmly walk away, find a teacher or other adult, and speak up. And do your part. Be that adult they can talk to and trust will listen. Join me to help stop bullying. Go to stopbullying.gov to find out more.
If you drive buzzed, it could cost you around $10,000. You'll face major legal fees, major fines, and steep insurance penalties. You could lose everything. Nothing kills a buzz like getting pulled over for buzz driving, because buzz driving is drunk driving.
And welcome back to Around Amesbury. I'm Meryl Goldsmith, your host, with Holly Shea and Patty Hoyt. So I feel like I know Jordan so much better, having heard about him from, you know, being a little kid all the way to his high school years at the construction project, formerly known as a high school. And, you know, and does feel a little, makes my hair kind of stand on end a little bit to, you know, hear him express himself. And maybe that's what... you know, people who are serving do, is they want people to know at home, God forbid something happens, this mm-hmm. is what, you know, I would like to have happen. But boy, you know, Holly, you've made this happen in kind of a big way. So Jordan passed away in the fall of 2009, and by April of 2010, we have the first Jordan M. Shea Memorial Bowling Tournament. And you originally had reached out to Kathy Toomey to say, okay, Kathy, I have to do what Jordan said, I guess. And you know, we want to. This is not going to be a bake sale. We want to raise some money and do scholarships, and you know. So talk me through that a little bit. You know, that seems, you know, in between going through your grief over your son passing and then putting this together, and wow.
I think it's a nice way to channel grief, you know, to find a project and go
take
with it.
Take some action.
But certainly it wasn't something that I did on my own. I mean, my friend Sue DeRocky really handles a lot of the logistics for the tournament,
okay.
and is definitely the go-to person for that. And Kelsey has been remarkable, too. She has been very motivated, and we've had a great team. as far as putting that together. So yes, I suppose it is a big jump to go from grief to planning, but in this particular case, it gave me purpose, so that was okay.
And probably some healing, I think, too. Sure. I mean, at least I know that's how I would feel instead of just sitting you're doing.
How did you decide on a bowling tournament? Excuse me for interrupting, but I did that.
No, that wasn't my idea. That was Kelsey. We were kind of tossing around different ideas, and Kelsey said, how about bowling? And, you know, I can't bowl.
And, Patty and I proved that yet again at the last bowling tournament.
But, I said, that sounds good. As long as I can meet and greet and I don't have to bowl, great.
Yeah.
And then we went with it, and it's been outstanding.
Mm-hmm. It has been outstanding. Yeah. We just recently had the fourth annual Jordan M. Shea Memorial Bowling Tournament. The wonderful folks at Leo's, I mean, they just,
they're
fabulous. We take over the place.
Right. Mike is an angel.
Yeah, absolutely. And you've raised a lot of money over the past 4 years. Mm-hmm. I think just this one was what, netting about 14,000 or something?
I think this one was well over 14.
Wow. I mean,
that's amazing.
It's amazing. And what I think is amazing about the bowling tournament, I think I've been to it 3 out of the 4 years, bowled 2 out of the 4. I don't know if I'm going to be asked back to bowl next year, but I'll always go. I'm amazed at, we take every lane.
Yes.
At Leo's, and you know, everybody who's really anybody is bowling, whether they're good at it or not. You know, the police and the fire and the Rotary Club and all the banks, and obviously Effie has a team, and you know, the school, the superintendent Michelle Robinson, she was on a team,
right.
And Roy Hammond, the principal. Who am I missing? I mean, it's really just an amazing...
Yeah, lots of friends, every organization.
And a lot
understood.
Of his friends are also,
right.
you know...
And what, people got turned away this
yes,
year. There were so many that wanted to do it.
The last few years we've had to turn people away waiting for a spot to open up for them. We had talked at one time of maybe having it over a couple of nights, but we thought focusing on one night would be the way to go.
And and another part of it, I mean, the teams do pay a fee to bowl and then raise some money. There's some amazing... you know, raffle prizes and stuff that, you know, take a lot of effort to put together, but do raise a lot of money. And it's just a plain, fun, silly night, which seems a little bit of a contradiction. You know, you're honoring his memory, but everybody is out there, you know.
I don't find it to be a contradiction,
though. Right.
Not at all.
Every
time that we've had the bowling tournament, there's been at least one point where I've walked through and hear the music and listen to everyone laugh and have a good time and can feel Jordan.
Yeah.
You know,
I know
he would love it.
Right.
It has a Jordan vibe to it. It's very low-key, laid back. Fun.
Yeah.
I'm absolutely fine with that. He would love it. He wouldn't want, you know,
a somber
occasion. He was very fun loving and the first to crack a joke. So.
All right. Well, that is that kind of an event.
A real celebration of his life. The party goes on.
Absolutely.
You know, that we're all there to remember him. Mm-hmm. That's our first purpose of being there.
Absolutely. Right? Yeah. So you are right. I was just kind of trying to put myself in your shoes and, you know, taking that all in. But
well, you always want your child remembered.
Yes.
You know, and what a beautiful way to remember someone's child.
Right.
And even if, you know, you didn't really know him. I mean, I didn't personally meet him. I don't know if, you know, some of the, like the police and the fire, if they really, you know, knew him as a person. Maybe not, since some of them are so much older than him. But just coming out and supporting such a great cause. You know, in addition to, you know, raising money with that, I mean, we have, through the Amesbury Educational Foundation, there's a scholarship and a grant fund. And the other big thing, in addition to awarding scholarships to, you know, either seniors going into, you know, police or fire or, you know, or somebody that is deserving, is every year we've been, the Amesbury Educational Foundation has been awarding these $10,000 Jordan M. Shea Memorial Grants.
Right.
And really every school has just about benefited. And these are $10,000 grants.
Right.
Each one is $10,000. So over at the elementary school, it's the playground equipment, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Here at the high school, there are two grants. I think two years ago, Barbara Leary got a grant for the math department. And just in this past fall, there was a really interesting grant funded through Jess Regis, who's a math teacher here at the high school. And, you know, it's a grant that is pretty much focused down at Lowell's Boat Shop. It's a $10,000 grant. Mm-hmm. And Patty, I want you to speak a little bit about it, because mm-hmm. I live down kind of in that area, and I see you down there directing traffic when the kids, no, with your orange vest on, you look very official. With the
because
orange vest.
I don't want to get hit.
No, or anybody right. else, but I happen to be driving by when, you know, they obviously the kids have been, you know, let off, and you're, mm-hmm. you know, getting them all to get over into Lowell's, and, you know, so what was the name of the grant? It's got a very interesting
name.
When
are we ever going to use this?
When are we ever going to use this?
The question that every math teacher and probably every English teacher and every yeah. teacher has always heard over the years, you know, when are we ever going to use this?
Yeah.
So Jessica collaborated with Graham McKay, who's the master boat builder at Lowell's, and he had just gone through training last spring, a year ago, to learn how to develop a program where you can teach math through boat building skills and nautical skills, maritime skills. So he persuaded her that this would be something that they could try as a different way of giving kids motivation to see a practical side of math. She wrote the grant, but the wonderful part, I think, is that it isn't just the math part. It is collaborating with the humanities teachers and social studies teachers. So we have, over the course of the year, had two math classes come, one in the fall and one in the spring, and there's still one more that's going to come before the end of school. We had the local history class come four times during the winter, and then we had the sophomore humanities class come, the American Studies 1 class, and each of those classes got a different curriculum, a different attitude, approach to it. And the local history and the American Studies classes are the ones I was directly involved in helping set up that curriculum. I wasn't involved in setting up the math curriculum or using sextants or anything, but the grant has provided the transportation as well as the equipment of the sextants, and it also pays for the training for Graham and for the woman who helps with the rowing component for the math classes. Mm-hmm. That's what's really special, that this group of kids, the math kids, have been able to get out on the mm-hmm. river. And what we have heard over and over again from all of these high school students who have lived in Amesbury all their lives, they have never been on the river.
Right.
They've never...
In one of those boats that,
in
you
one
know,
of the boats.
Yeah.
So it's not just the math, which is amazing in itself, but it's learning to row that boat together as a team has been perhaps one of the best lessons.
Yeah, working as a team.
Because that river is pretty strong.
Yeah.
It is pretty strong.
But I know there's been a lot of newspaper coverage of, the kids just... not even, you know, believing that it could be as fun and as interesting right. as the right. experience is. So that also, Holly, must give you joy when you hear stuff like that.
Right. And it's sustainable, too, because this is not just for 1 year. This is going on next year
Excellent.
As well. And so what we've done is really established a longstanding relationship between our boat shop, which is really the best piece of history that we have in the community, yeah. and it's also best known in the country as well. So there's so much that can be developed mm-hmm. in it. And it was one of those things that we always wanted to do in the school system, but and at Lowell's as well, but it was always the stumbling block is, well, how do you get the kids back there and back to class in time? And it requires a bus because it's
and
just
a bus requires money.
And the bus requires money.
Yeah.
And so field trips are really the best way to get kids out into the community and have hands-on education, which I know is really important to mm-hmm. To everybody. For all of us
sure.
believe in that. Jordan appreciated it. I heard from Bruce, who was a friend of Graham's, that mm-hmm. That he had taken Jordan deep sea diving and that
yes.
they had learned a lot about fishing. They enjoyed fishing. So I think that's something that also establishes Jordan's legacy, you know, that mm-hmm. here is a place, a way of life of adventuring.
Mm-hmm.
and right in our own community.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
So it's a great opportunity for kids.
And I know that we just recently had the Hall of Honor event that Effie does every year, and you had a surprise grant, another $10,000, because your fundraising is doing so well, and to buy a new kiln for the Cashman School. I guess the kiln there is like 35 years old and it's barely working and held together by, you know, I don't know what. And so that's a something that Kelsey was really interested in, because that was something that really made an impact on her elementary years, was being able to do that project with Karen Greenfield, who's our teacher over at the Cashman School. So that's something that just happened. And you know, it was a big surprise at our recent Hall of Honor.
Right.
So, you know, Jordan lives on here in our community in very big ways, especially with all the children who go to school here in Amesbury.
Right.
So we're gonna wrap up here. Is there anything else that you'd like to tell us about Jordan or about, you know, the grants or, you know?
I just think that we never would have been as successful with this venture if not for the community. So we're very grateful to the community for their support. So it's one thing to not want your child forgotten, but it's another thing entirely to have it, you know, have his legacy flourish in such a way that makes him unforgettable. So we wouldn't have been able to do that alone. We really have the community to thank for that.
Thank you, Holly.
That's great.
Thank you, Patty. And thank you for watching our premiere edition of Around Amesbury. Want to thank Kathy Gannett, who helped us put this beautiful set together from Attentive Design. We went to all our friends in Amesbury to help us put this together, because that's also important, including Amesbury Chair, for this type of stuff. But we want to thank Kathy. And thank you both. Thank you for talking about your son and allowing us to know him a little better. What an inspiration.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you. And thank you, Patty.
Thank you.
And I hope you'll tune in again to another Around Amesbury, and we'll be providing you some contact information about how to submit story ideas and to be in touch with us. That'll be scrolling on your screen. Have a great day. Take care.